very, very glad that he started out in the outdoor theater. So the outdoor space. Brother Cooper, Sister Cooper,
right, right there.
Do you think we have everybody, or should Ashley still look for stragglers? So let me say, there were two really, really smart comments as they first came into the theater. The first comment is somebody said, the play we saw last year, it was in that theater, right? And I love it when people say that, because they're wrong, okay? And it tells me that that theater where you were, which is beautiful and gorgeous and has been there since 1977, the theater that is across the street, which was built to replace that theater, needed to capture the same actor-audience relationship that we had with all of the other theatrical amenities that are there. So the fact that, where did he go? He said, is that where Three Musketeers? That you thought that you were in that space. And I've given tours of both spaces, and I'll take a tour of the Ingolstadt, and they'll say, now where's the new theater? I said, which new theater are you talking about? The new outdoor Shakespeare theater. I said, that is here. They go, but it looks just like the old one. And I say, yes. Now those of us, I'm looking for my cedar crowd that moved around. Those of us that have been around here, we know there are differences. The first difference, which we as actors, if I took you backstage, I mean, there is no backstage. You step outside, so there's no costume or dressing rooms area here, no costume shop area, it's like down in the tunnel, etc. And lighting, they have to hang and do jerry rig, things like that. So you now have a state-of-the-art facility that still protects the outdoor acoustical experience that you saw of the 70 who came and saw Three Musketeers. And so our goal is to make sure that we still maintain that. So way back in the history lesson I was giving, so Fred created that theater in 61. That was built in 77. It wasn't completely built. They eventually built the upper Tyring House about a year later after that. There are pictures of people holding programs like this as the sun beats down on them. I say that because presently we're trying to solve some sun issues over here in this theater and some sound issues that this theater never had, except they did, long time. Because things take time. But this year we're feeling much better because now we've been a year or 2 years in space. The second comment that I received is they said, is this the theater where we're going to be seeing, is this the Randall Theater? Is this the indoor theater that we're going to be seeing Midsummer Night's Dream? And the answer is no. This theater was built in the late in 1955. And in 1955, they used it, and they sometimes used it for Shakespeare things, etc. We used it during the school year. But the theater that we're going to see the show in takes place in the Randall Theater that was built in 1989. And 1989 was a magical year here. It was a terrible recession that was going on. But at the time, 3.5 million from economic development was given to the festival because while the economy was down and iron mining was down and the economy had been destroyed, there was one industry that was going very, very well, and that was the Shakespeare Festival. And so they built that theater for Shakespeare's of Other Lands. And then there's another theater called the Ames Theater. How many of you have seen the Ames Theater? The Ames Theater, 200-seat theater for up-and-coming Shakespeare's. A 200-seat house which allows us to do plays that might be more avant-garde or might require smaller audiences or that are written by young playwrights or etc. That's in that Ames Theater. And it's a very, very intimate theater experience, which is what we like to capture in all of those. Okay? Cool? Any questions before I jump into the show you're going to see tonight about the festival like that? I love seeing all those new hands. Is it raining a lot? Yeah? Fantastic. It's good. No, we like it. When it rains now, and it rains like, I think I hear it, but when it rains now at this time, then we're fine for the show. You guys are fine anyway because you're going into an indoor theater. Okay? So, how many of you have seen the show Midsummer Night's Dream before? Midsummer Night's Dream before. Fantastic. How many of you have never seen Midsummer Night's Dream before? Majority! Yes! Yes! It's Shakespeare! Ah! There is no reason to be terrified of this show. God bless William Shakespeare for writing Macbeth and writing Midsummer Night's Dream, because both of those shows are introduced in elementary schools. This is the one with the donkey. This is the one with the fairies. And it's wonderfully accessible. But for those of you that have seen it 45,000 times like I have, every time we do it another day, every time we do a different version with it, in a different setting, in different costume designs, you learn something different. You say, wow, I never heard that line before. I never saw that before. So the production you'll be seeing today is performed inside, which allows us to do a lot of really wonderful technical magic. In other words, there's some really wonderful light and sound effects, and you'll know what I'm talking about when you see that. Some of them will just happen, and you won't think about them. You say, wow, that'd be interesting to rehearse that, because the light and the sound is so important to that. It is set in 1920s. So this is right in that wonderful kind of period where women are stepping out a little bit. I know they've stepped out a number of times. But you guys are a great crowd. Even with those bad Mormon jokes, you're a great crowd. So during the 20s, the flappers, the 20s were to them what the 60s were to us. And I know you don't necessarily think of it that way, but women's right to vote, women first being able to kind of speak up, etc. That I don't want you to think a lot about that because you think, how does this work? How does this work? It's just a kind of wonderful setting for Shakespeare at this time because that's one of the issues that you'll deal with within this show, okay? Let me get into the plot, and then I'll let you make your own assumptions about, wow, seeing it this way allowed me to see it in this setting, allowed me to hear this. I think mostly seeing it in this setting. A lot of times some people say, I prefer my Shakespeare straight. I want to see tights. I want to see pumpkin pants. You know, unless I see collars around their necks, I just don't enjoy it. Some of our audiences have challenges with that. And then they see it, and after they get them seeing it, they say, you changed those words on me. Why did I understand it? It sounded like he was speaking English. And I'll say, that's because it is English. And sometimes stripping away things that you have to fight through makes it more accessible to you so that you can understand and see that. I treasure Shakespeare done in modern times. I treasure Shakespeare done in those original things. But the reason why we put it in those different settings is to allow you to see and see a different slant. If you saw when we did Midsummer, I'm looking for Jeff Cooper. Where did Cooper say? There they are. If you saw Fred's Midsummer Night's Dream, which you can sometimes still see on BYU television, I can tell this crowd that. It was done outside. It was a very, very classic. Very, very classic version. Same story, same words, same lines, etc. We've just changed the lighting, the setting, etc. Consequently, I think there's some plot things that resonate a little stronger than they necessarily hear, where these things resonate a little stronger. And you can talk about that on your way back to Vegas, St. George, or prepare one. So it opens with a guy named Theseus. And Duke Theseus is getting married. He's getting married to a queen of the Amazons, Wonder Woman, that should have some distance. Hippolyta is her name. And he says, I wooed thee with my sword and won thee for my love. That basically means that he conquered her, and he's captured here, and here she is. Some predictions make a big deal about that. It's an interesting accent, and there's just a little bit that you could probably look at that and say, so here we are, and then he says to her in 1920s dress, he said, what are we going to do? How are we going to pass our time in these pre-nuptial times? So husband and wife-to-be are here, and their solitude is interrupted by this very angry father. This very angry father comes in by the name of Aegeus, and he says, my daughter Hermia has to get married to the person that I say she has to marry. Wow. We're great outside. You would have heard it because you would have been drenched.
Heard that thunder?
So in that time, whether it's 20s or whether it's back in Shakespeare's day, or even if you want to apply it to the present, he says, Duke, you make her do what I say. And she says, I want to marry Lysander. Lysander is a good man. Can I please marry him? In fact, I want that to happen. He says, no. He needs to marry Demetrius. Demetrius is the one that he should marry. And at that point, Lysander speaks up, which probably isn't appropriate. He Shakespeare's day or in the Duke of Athens' court or even in our present day, that stands up and says, hey, I know that Demetrius made love to Nestor's daughter, Helena, and that he, and Theseus says, I've heard about that too. So already, the plot that's going to happen later on, you're getting the seeds of that. So you find out that Demetrius had some type of relationship with the girl named Helena, who we've yet to meet. Okay. They debate back and forth further. They make a threat. He says, I want the ancient privilege of Athens, that she does what I say or we put her up to death. Okay, all right? Strict here, right? Strict. And he says, no, I'm a merciful guy. She can be a nun, but she's got to either do what her dad says or she becomes a nun. Okay, all right? So that's the opening of this really wonderful comedy. Okay? Suddenly after that,